This is Teclast F5, so it is a super portable, very light and thin 2-in-1 laptop. This one here has an 11.6-inch screen, and as you can see, can be used as a tablet. So you can flip the screen around like that, and it becomes a 1.05 kilo tablet. So after a while, yeah, it gets a little bit heavy, but then you can, of course, use that keyboard like a stand and prop it up into this presentation mode here. So because of the size, and this is always going to happen, you do have some compromises with a laptop like this one here. So we don't have any full-size ports on this. We've got a Type-C port with 4K output, data and charging all at the same time, a USB 2 port, micro USB 2, and then we do have 4K up to 60 hertz out, which is really good. So it's HDMI 2 spec on this one. Now when you take a look at the left-hand side, we've got a 3.5mm headphone jack with good output on this. It's clean, there's no static, there's no interference, plastic power on buttons and volume button there on the side. And when you pick it up, you sometimes accidentally do touch these ones here, the power button, put it into sleep. And that's just one of those things there that you can actually set in the settings of Windows to have it do nothing. And you can just pretty much fix that problem and solve it. So the keyboard. Because it is so small, this is not going to be a keyboard for everyone. I don't have huge hands, and I found that with my medium-sized hands that typing on this keyboard does take a while to adapt to and get used to. Now, because it's not a full-size keyboard, we don't have a lot of keys on here. So no page, home, up and down, no print screen button that I like to use myself a lot. That's missing, unfortunately. Now, the feel of the keys is okay. Some of the keys, when pressed, don't have a super quality feel to them, like the Enter key, for example. If you don't hit it right in the middle, for me, and on the edges, tends to sometimes feel just a little bit clicky and funny, but it registers every time. There's no missed keystrokes and there is no keyboard lag, which is the main thing here. So overall, an okay keyboard. It's not the greatest. The best for me so far is the Chewy Laptop SE. Same goes for the touchpad. While it is a Windows Precision based one, so it's using Windows Precision drivers, the accuracy is good. It's a little bit smaller, so again, not quite as comfortable there. Now the palm rest, this is made out of plastic with this model here. And you will note that we do have the webcam too in a funny position. So it's one of those look up your nose style ones there, which is not the greatest. So this screen turns out to be a little bit of a surprise here with the F5. Now it has good color gamut. The coverage is great. It's got sRGB coverage of 97%. Adobe RGB coverage is also 73%. This is better than some of the $1,000 laptops. In fact, a lot of the $1,000 laptops that I've looked at, gaming ones, tend to have very poor average displays in them, and even business laptops. So it's a nice surprise to have such a good screen in this. The brightness, however, isn't the greatest. Now, I feel Teclast have probably toned this down because of the battery life. Now, being so small, another compromise is the battery capacity. So it's 29 watt hours. And with my fresh install of Windows 10, I'm only getting 4 hours, and even struggling to get 4 hours. So if you must have good battery life, then you're not going to get it with this unit. This thing is all about portability. And lastly, taking a look at the rear. So we do have a tiny little hatch here that you can easily access and replace the 128 gigabyte SSD. If that's not enough for you, you can put a SATA 3 M.2 spec one in here. Up to 512 gigabytes, and the one that's included is okay. It has reads of about 500 sequential, but writes are quite slow, only about 150 megabytes sequential. But let's get into more detail about just how well this particular laptop performs.
So there's some things I wanted to point out here that, of course, we're running 8 gigabytes of RAM here, and yes, you do notice it. It does feel a little more fluid, a little smoother when just doing normal operations and things in and about Windows versus the 4 you get, for example, on the Laptop SE or the EasyBook X4 that I have tested out. And you can see my CPU use that is rather high at the moment because I've got some things going on there. Chrome is running, and I don't know why it's that high. It's probably just updating. But just to point out that this memory, yes, it is actually running in dual channel. Now, I've checked this out with HW Info, and you can see the speed's not the highest supported. Now, according to the RAM, it will actually support 2.4 gigahertz, but at the moment it's only running at 2.133. The good news is, of course, we're going to get a little bit more RAM bandwidth there, and you do see that when you take a look at our benchmarks. So what I'm showing you first is just the wireless speeds here. So we've got that Intel wireless AC3165, and those were the maximum speeds I managed to get out of my router here. Now, at home with my FTP server, set up an STP server, you can push around 350, 320. Now, back to what I was talking about with the RAM. So, dual channel RAM, and you see the multi-core score here is actually reasonably good for this type of chipset. So, the Celeron, this is the N4100. I've reviewed now a lot of them. And the single core score should be a little higher here. You can see compared to the Lapbook SE that one's a little higher, but the multi-core score is up around about 340 points or so there. So it does make a difference having that extra RAM, even in synthetic benchmarks like this. So we'll take a little look at general performance here. So right now I'm just gonna load up bbc.co.uk. I haven't loaded this up before, so that's the reason why I'm doing that, to see how fast it is. You can see that pops in pretty quick. Now I'm gonna use my finger now with the scrolling, and that's not the smoothest I have seen. So scrolling down there, that is in general good, but it's just not the smoothest I have seen, because this is quite a heavy website as well. But saying that, it does feel a little smoother than the Lapbook SE. Now the start menu is one area that I'm seeing always a bit of lag with this tech. So the Apollo Lakes, the Gemini Lake as well, I was doing it. So when I hit the start menu, see how that loads in a little sluggish? It's a little bit of stutter there. That, unfortunately, is still happening. It's just something with this hardware. I think it's to do with the Intel UHD drivers, just the way they've got it set up, that it's not exactly the highest performer there. So we'll test out a video clip. This is what I normally do. So this is Jellyfish, an MKV file that is encoded with the HEVC 10-bit encoding. And this is 140 megabits per second, so it's a very demanding file. Double tap that, and we'll see how quickly this loads in. So you can see it's a little slow to start. And you'll see this, stutters, in the beginning. Get a bit, but once it gets going, it smooths out and that runs actually perfectly fine for this very demanding file. So I will skip ahead now. And you can see that was pretty quick. So once it's going, then it stops dropping frames there. So that performance, I mean, that is really good for this type of file. Now let's also take a look at 4K streaming. So I'll do this in YouTube. I'm just gonna load up any random 4K demo file. I could also light up my own videos as well because I shoot them in 4K, but let's just go for 4K demo right here and see what that brings up. Load that in. Whoops, that was very poor typing on my behalf there. Okay, there we go, 4K demo, so let's just go for this one here. And I'll do the usual, so I'll just mute this to start with. And let's make sure this is in the 4K setting. Enable our stats for nerds and hit full screen. So, drop frames. This is in Chrome, and Chrome tends to drop a few in the beginning, and then it seems to settle down, but still not quite perfect though, is it? You can see it's stuttering a little bit. Now, if you do the same in Edge, Edge is going to run this perfectly fine. It will not actually drop any frames, only when you maximize and minimize the video. You can see it's running a little better, but it is still definitely dropping a chunk of frames there, which is not good. Now, I also have open in the background, but this has got nothing really to do with Chrome dropping the frames there, is I've got LibreOffice right here. So this is basic spreadsheet. So your Word files, spreadsheets, Word, it's all good on this. The 8 gigabytes of RAM is helping. And if you're, of course, running a slightly faster SSD with better writes, then things might pick up a little bit when it comes to saving things. But overall, this performance is decent. Now, this is a very... well, it's relatively large, this spreadsheet. So when you're finding things, searching or moving around, that isn't too bad. I also have Photoshop open right here. So I'm just gonna go and load up a recent sample that I have been editing. This is the sample I load for all my tests. And you can see that it takes a little while to load this in. And this doesn't have a lot of layers or anything like that. So minor edits, basic edits and things like that with Photoshop are gonna be fine. Now, if you wanna edit videos, on this hardware with the 4 gigabytes of RAM, 1080p video editing is possible, but be warned, it is slow and it can be painfully slow when encoding. Use something like PowerDirector. The latest versions of PowerDirector, they're all supporting Intel's QuickSync, so the encoding times will actually be a little bit faster there, but it's not really recommended. I recommend going for something like a Core i5 minimum machine if you're going to be editing a lot of video, not on this particular hardware right here. So there were a couple of concerns there, people asking me to test out the Bluetooth. So I did pair this up to some speakers, and I found that in my experience, the Bluetooth range, yes, it's not the best. So you're only looking at about half a room's length before it started to break up, started cracking up and getting crackling effects, and it would just come in and out the audio. So the Bluetooth range on this isn't the greatest. Now, normally I can get at least a room's length away from things. So bear that in mind, you want to keep it a little bit closer. I don't know why this is. Perhaps it's the way they've arranged the aerial. They have things set up there. And the thermals that I think I have already pointed out to you. So these are very good. So the thermals, 84 degrees max. And this was after 1 hour and 11 minutes. Now, I have not done any copper heatsink mod. I don't actually believe it is necessary here. So you don't need to open this one up. You don't need to apply any of those fixes there. And you can see it even consumes close to, this is 13.5, but I've seen it up to 14 watts when gaming the power consumption. So it is basically running an unlimited power limit here. Now, I showed this in the unboxing video, but I will quickly just let you know that with Linux support, there are two major things here. So the touchscreen is not working at all. And the other thing is the wireless for some reason. Now, normally the Intel wireless AC3165 will work perfectly fine. But in this case, it is not working. So that's something you're going to have to contend with. You have to wait for that to be obviously fixed, patched with the kernels and driver support there. So Linux support not looking good so far on this system. Hopefully later on that will be addressed.
So normally with the typical tech that I review out of China, the speakers, they sound terrible on these devices. The laptops, the tablets, they're flat, there's no bass, they lack volume. Not the case here. So really good surprise here from Teclast that the speakers have a bit of bass. They're side firing, you get good stereo separation, and the loudness as well is decent. Here's a sample. Okay, so here's a sample from the webcam. So the location of it is like the Dell XPS a little bit. It's right down there in the bottom where most people are not going to be looking. Now, if you do listen carefully, can you hear that? There's a tiny little bit of interference coming through from the mics, which is unfortunate. Apart from that, this webcam and, of course, the location of it, the webcam quality is good. This is much better than the Chewy Lapbook SE's webcam, which was really blurry on my unit.
And then on to gaming. So League of Legends here, this is 1080p, and I have it set to the medium preset. And you can see their frame rate, well, it's not wonderful, around 27 frames per second, dipping down a little bit. You'd expect better, wouldn't you, from the 8GB of RAM. Now, as I mentioned before, that even though the TPD, which is the power limit, is set to 9 watts, it will actually consume right up to about 14 or so. So we are getting about the maximum performance here. But it just, I think you probably need to just lower the settings down on this one. So I now set it to very low on 1080p. Okay, and there we go. And that now brings the frame rate up to about 30 frames per second, 29. In fact, that hasn't really given us much of an improvement at all there, which is really quite strange. And now taking a look at Counter-Strike here, you can see that the frame rate isn't wonderful, 24, 22 frames per second. It's quite slow. This is 720p, and it is on the lower settings. But really, you probably want to actually lower the resolution, I would say, down to 800x600. That'll give you a little bit of a boost there to the frame rate, but it's not ideal. I mean, this is not as smooth as you'd want it to be here. Now, the server, I think, is, yeah, it's pretty much a full server. So it is in its most demanding at the moment. Of course, this is the Dust 2 map online. And it's just a shame about that frame rate. If we could make it over 30 frames per second the whole time, that would be just so much better. I would have thought with the extra RAM, the extra 4GB versus the other hardware, that we might be able to do that, but sadly that is not the case here.
Okay guys, so this laptop, okay, it's all about compromises, of course, with the size. So the smaller keyboard, the battery life's the big thing for me. Only 4 hours, that's just not good enough. It's just, if it was 6 hours, then I wouldn't have any problems recommending this laptop for its size. I mean, this thing's so small and tiny. I love the weight of it. It's just so portable, which is great. Really decent screen on this. The color gamut that it has, the coverage is just so much better than you would expect for this category of laptop, or one out of China with this kind of brand. Touch response at times is a little bit flaky. You sometimes have to tap again. I don't know whether that's a fault of Windows because of the smaller screen size at 11.6 inches, or maybe the touch digitizer itself just isn't quite that accurate. Now, it does have a stylus, which unfortunately was not featured in this video because it was just not going to make it in time. And I didn't fancy ordering one with DHL or express shipping, having to pay about 50 euros tax on one, which has happened to me before when getting a stylus for one of these particular laptops. So overall, it really boils down to that. Battery life, can you live with it? If you can live with it, then it's a decent little laptop. Thank you so much for watching this review here, and I do hope to see you back in the channel for more upcoming videos. Make sure you check out my Lapbook SE video up here, which is another Gemini Lake laptop that I recently reviewed. And then of course the Teclast F6 Pro, that's their Corium version, larger version of this particular laptop really. This is the baby one. Bye for now.